Hey guys, I'm full of a chair. This week we are going to talk about speaking in tongues. Holy Spirit, what?
What?
Let's dive in.
We're live.
Hey everyone, welcome to the Pastor's Hangover. My name is Melissa, and each week I get to chat with you all and some wonderful pastors at Grace Family Church. So we are going to dive in. And this week with us is Pastor Hal Mayer.
Hello, hello.
Pastor Craig Altman.
Yes.
The one and only.
Yes.
The.
The. No, that's the. Just trying to say I'm old. Shut up.
And Pastor Daryl Black.
Hello, hello.
And hey, we're excited.
Someone asked the other day, this is the teaching team of Grace Family Church. So these are the three guys. We teach most of the messages on the weekends. I had that question asked several times. So we sprinkle in with some other people, but this is the teaching team that God's given us. And and I love each voice because it's different and good. And so.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you, Craig.
Yeah.
He looked at me when he said different. So
different and good. That was what he said. That.
He said different and he looked at me good and he looked at you. But that's all right. You know, that's
how you get the message.
And it is a teaching model, which is different than some other churches that people are coming here for the first time, right? The three of you teach in rotation in a teaching model, and it really allows more time for the next teacher to prepare for their message. Prepared.
Yeah, like a crock pot. It gets better when you get to spend a little more time with
it. Yeah, exactly.
And it's incredible diversity. None of us teach the same.
No, different styles.
Very different, but all still very impactful.
Yeah.
Love it.
It is awesome. And actually, this episode is sponsored by Ford's Garage in Wesley Chapel.
Oh, Listen, we got to speed up this episode because I smell the food out there. But we'd love, I've been to Ford's many times, by the way. Probably the best hamburger around, seriously.
We can't wait.
Yeah, I've had it many times.
Well, I'm excited to eat. Megan and some of the people at the ownership group of Ford's Garage.
Megan.
Thank you so much. They go to Grace Family Church, faithful here, and they just called and said, we would love to bless the pastors and provide them some lunch today.
Our first sponsored lunch.
Our first sponsored lunch. Man, awesome. Let's do it. Or is this our second? Because we did have $1 million bacon.
We did have a bacon. I don't know if
and
I
we
clapped.
Had coffee,
I
missed ragged
one.
Coffee.
It wasn't a
lot. I was gone that week.
You missed the
you
bacon.
Were, man.
Yeah.
Okay.
This one works out perfectly.
Right. And we had coffee.
Yes, we had ragged coffee.
Coffee.
We had coffee,
for sure.
But we haven't
coffee.
Had
we're getting coffee. Popular, guys.
We haven't had hamburgers yet.
Ooh, no,
come on.
All right, so we are going to run through. Thank you, Ford's Garage Wesley Chapel, and we're going to chat through Pastor Hal's message this weekend. And before we get to your message, Pastor Hal, this is what we've been calling Scary Week because
scary
we have
week.
Halloween coming up and the election.
Yeah, both are scary.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we've gotten a lot of questions about Halloween. Which one's scarier?
The election.
Yeah.
It's scary.
For sure.
But we talked about that last week.
Yeah.
Yes, we did. Go back and listen. That was a just impactful, powerful episode.
Yeah.
But Halloween. Mm-hmm. Let's just chat briefly on Halloween. Parents want to know, where does Grace Family Church stand? How did you navigate it with your kids? How do you feel about Halloween? Let's just
Well, can I start by chat. Saying I really Halloween is not a biblical holiday, but I tell my grandkids, when you go out there, get me some almond joys. So that's how I feel about Halloween.
Craig's like, I just want the candy.
Want the candy.
That's it.
And I think that answers anybody's question about Halloween.
Wow.
Yeah, it's not he said it. It's not a biblically founded holiday or anything like that. I mean, it can get crazy when you get into Ouija boards and all the other mystical things, and things can get a little bit crazy. But you know, this is not it's not a topic on judgment. You know, you have to use your wisdom and discernment on what to do and how to do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that we just want to provide that. Yeah, is it a biblical holiday? Of course not.
Mm-hmm.
But
your family didn't practice it.
We didn't grow up practicing.
You went to someone else's house and got the candy.
And I got all the candy.
There you go.
Like people always ask me, hey, man, you didn't grow up celebrating Halloween. Was it weird? And it wasn't.
Yeah.
No.
And you would think it would be. And my kids didn't grow up celebrating Halloween. And it wasn't weird for us.
No.
And, you know, one of the things that we did do is we had costume parties all throughout the year.
Yeah.
We've got pictures in our home of us just dressing up because we wanted to dress up.
Yeah.
And so if you want to dress up in July.
Yeah.
It's like you want to put a costume on, put a costume on.
Yeah.
Big deal.
Yeah, we had the harvest festivals. I don't know.
Yeah.
If you had,
alternative,
that kind of deal.
Thing.
But I think the thing is, yeah, if your kid is dressed up like a firefighter or whatever, that's not. And I'll just say this one thing. This is the one time of year where people come to you.
Yeah.
So it's the one time a year where we have the opportunity to meet all of our neighbors, everybody around them. One of the things my dad started doing was just handing out hot dogs, giving out drinks, all that kind of stuff to the adults and trying to start conversations. So I think it's one of those opportunities we have just by handing out candy. You are not invoking
not
a demon lord
worship
or anything like that. Like, that's not happening.
But there are real things that happen on that day. There are groups that have a big kind of weird celebration. And so,
If you came to my house when I was little, my father's giving you one of those little Bibles.
There you go.
And kids hated that.
A piece of candy with it or
No candy.
Come on, you got to bait and switch candy.
Wow.
Hey, I've given out invite cards with candy. And you got to give out good. You got to give good candy if you're going to give out invite card.
Good candy, like what?
Yeah.
Peanut butter cups. And
like some decent stuff.
Yeah, good stuff.
You're not giving away that what is that orange and brown wrap stuff. Yeah, I don't even know what that
What's your favorite candy bar? What's your favorite candy bar?
Snickers.
Yours.
Reese's.
Mine's Almond Joy.
Yeah.
I would say either Mounds or Almond Joy. I do.
There you go.
I love the coconut and chocolate.
Really?
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah. All right.
It's just such a old people candy. I feel
what do you like?
I said Reese's.
Reese's.
Well, do you call it Reese's or Reese's? I call it Reese's.
Peanut butter cups have been around for a long time.
Yeah. I'm just saying the coconut. I never make jokes like that, but it's not a joke. I'm just saying.
Okay. It's not a joke. Only old people like coconut? It's like a
I'm going to stand by what I'm saying.
Where has this podcast gone?
She's from New York.
I'm going to say.
Come on.
Yeah, and this was the last time you guys saw me on the Pastor's Hangover.
There you go.
Let's get to it. Let's talk about the ghosts of Halloween. No, we are going to talk about the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
And we are going to talk about Hal's message this weekend on the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Please go back and listen to it. We will link it in the YouTube version. But powerful message.
You know, can I say something? The last 2 weeks have been good. And I love that you said Holy Ghost because that's an old term, and I think that actually alienated people to be afraid of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
But as Daryl said and as Hal said, he's a person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he wants to be with you every day. And so I just want to start. I'm glad you said Holy Ghost because we shouldn't be afraid of the Holy Spirit.
Not at all. Not at all. No, and that's the thing. And we spent 2 weeks on it. Not that you can cover everything about the Holy Spirit in 2 weeks, but just an idea and hopefully an understanding of who he is and what he does and why we need him every day. That's what we talk about it all the time, but just hopefully a greater understanding of that. Because he does. He helps us. He empowers us. He makes the church what it should be.
Yeah.
And so, we need him.
You know, I'm reminded of I think you shared this the first week, or maybe one of you did. When Jesus left the earth, he goes, "Hey, I'm not leaving you as an orphan."
Yep. Right.
Because he knows without the Holy Spirit, you can't live the Christian life.
Nope.
You won't live in victory. You'll live in defeat.
Mm-hmm.
And so we just really, our prayer is that you would be more engaged and aware that he's there.
Yeah.
Either he's lying dormant or he's active in your life.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a perfect gentleman. He's waiting on the invitation for you to involve him into your life.
Yeah.
So, you absolutely need him. It's a necessity, not an option.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel it would be kind of mean of God to go, this is the life you're supposed to live, and then not give us the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Because we can't do it. We literally can't do it.
I think there's a verse that says, the sons of God are led by the Spirit of God.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Man, I want to be led by the Spirit, because when I'm led by my own feelings or my own discernment sometimes, I end up in trouble.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So let's lean on him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. How were your feelings this last week?
Yeah, about the Buccaneers
it was an
losing.
Awful game.
Listen,
awful
if I game. Yeah, we want to go there. Let's stay on the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, there we go.
The Holy Spirit should give you grace and patience.
The fruits.
Man. Yeah,
the fruit of the Spirit.
Yes. That's a good subject. The fruit of the Spirit.
Yeah, I think it was fun to help people understand that probably a little bit better, because it is something I go, all right, I'm going to work on patience. All right, I'm going to work on this. And it's like, no, that's the entire wrong mindset that I'm just going to take a part of that and work on it. It is really something that the Holy Spirit does as a whole in our life over time.
Love, joy, peace, patience,
kindness,
goodness,
and when I said earlier, podcast was, remember, if it's fruit, it doesn't start fully developed. It starts as a seed. So all of us have the potential.
Yep.
To be more kind.
Yep.
You can't use that, well, I'm just this way. No, the Holy Spirit can actually develop some of these seeds in you to become fruit in your life.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And some of those fruit, all of those fruit, they're developing at different rates.
Yeah. Like my patience one, it's still a seed.
It's still a seed.
When's it going to grow? I'm terrible, man. Help me.
That's what Debbie's asked. But
I know exactly. Yeah.
But your joy is high.
Yeah, there you go.
So, yeah.
But the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, two different things, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You guys want to talk about the difference between the two?
Well, and I think the gifts is where people get the most freaked out, I would say. Mm-hmm. And I we kind of talked about it. It's kind of funny. I said in the message how different, like both of us grew up in church. Both of us dads are pastors, but the type of church we grew up in were very different.
Yeah.
We were definitely on the other side of going, that stuff is not for us. That's not something we want to walk into. But also be able to come now at where you are right now and read through the Bible, understand it, and go, no, this is of God. Mm-hmm. And I think the biggest thing that we do with the gifts of the Spirit is, one, we don't exercise them. We don't use them. Mm-hmm. We don't serve to find out what they are.
Yep.
Or we're just afraid of them.
Yeah.
Like, what happens if I do get that gift? I mean, is that going to make me weird? No, what it does is it makes you effective.
Yeah.
It may make you look weird to the outside world, but it's effective in what God has called you to do. Yep. And so we've got to lean into it. And really, we've got to serve. And spend time serving and asking those around us, like, what is it that you see that's different about me? Mm-hmm. So that we can develop it. But
that's good.
I think in Ephesians, Paul encourages, be filled with the Spirit. Yes. Do not be drunk with wine, but be filled. And it's funny you put those two together, because when you drink the wrong stuff, it influences you.
Yes.
But when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, it also influences you. Yep. It's supposed to be an influence
Absolutely.
In our lives.
Yeah, the gifts of the Spirit are to serve God and build up the church.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's really three areas in the Bible where it talks about the gifts of the Spirit: 1 Corinthians, mm-hmm. Romans 12, mm-hmm. and Ephesians.
I think so.
Yeah. Ephesians. So 1 Corinthians, for the people that are asking, man, what are the gifts of the Spirit as opposed to, you know, Galatians 5 that talks about the fruit of the Spirit: wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discernment, and tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Those are the gifts of the Spirit. That's just one section of the gifts of the Spirit. Then Romans 12 talks about prophecy, serving, teaching, encouragement, giving, leadership, or administration.
Isn't that funny?
And
a gift
mercy.
Is administration.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty.
That's
it
one.
It seems sexy, but that's one of the gifts.
Right.
But it's needed.
It's needed.
I mean, let's look at what happened after the hurricane. We needed people with a gift of administration.
Just getting things together
to get stuff done.
And administrate. People usually think administration like being I don't know, a secretary or an assistant. That's not a it is management and leadership and being able to analyze things and shepherd with wisdom across those different areas. So it's a lot of that. And do all people get everything? No. Yeah. Everybody doesn't get everything, but the Holy Spirit is able to delineate those gifts the way he wants.
He says that. And I give it to him as I will.
Yeah. As he wills. And while you may be gifted in a certain thing, you've said this before, it doesn't mean that those other things won't show up as may be needed in that moment. Let's say you got the gift of prophecy. It doesn't mean you, in a certain moment, you can't also display the gift of teaching.
That's right.
And you don't have the gift of teaching, but in that moment, the Holy Spirit used you as a teaching tool in the gift of teaching. And so, and then Ephesians, where it talks about what those leadership responsibilities, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. So there's all of these things which are available to all of us. Mm-hmm. And I've said this before, when people get nervous. When I grew up in the church where if you weren't speaking in tongues, everybody gets the gift of speaking in tongues. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you know, and that's what I grew up believing it probably until I was maybe 13 or 14, because that's until you read the Bible and go, well, that's not what it says. That's not what it says at all. And so we don't all get the same gift, but you don't know what gift you're going to get.
Yeah. Right.
So just pray, God, whatever you have for me, I'm willing to receive it. And it doesn't mean that you won't speak in tongues.
And you know, Daryl, you said something interesting in the moment. Like, a perfect example was when these hurricanes came through.
Yeah.
It activated certain gifts of the Holy Spirit. I just met people like, they have the gift of serving. They're like, they're in heaven. They're going out every day. Be honest with you, I don't want to go out every day and clean someone's yard.
Yeah.
I've helped, but that's just not me. But other people, that gift is activated to serve, to help with the logistics. And and that's why it's so cool that all these gifts sometimes are activated in a moment for a certain time.
Yeah. And even for the person that may not want to go out and serve, the Holy Spirit can use you in those moments to activate those gifts in that moment to go, wow, this is not something that I ever would have done on my own.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But man, it's, I was motivated and encouraged because of the Holy Spirit to go do something that I wouldn't have done.
And can we get to it real quick? Because there, when we mention all the gifts, people go right to tongues.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
And there's so much misinformation about tongues. So to clarify, there's two types of tongues. There's a tongues that's a public tongue, that when someone speaks in tongues in a group, there should be an interpretation. There's also what we call a private tongue, a private prayer language, which Paul says, I pray that you all speak in tongues. Doesn't mean everyone will, but and I think when I was in that place of searching, I had all this fear that had been taught to me that you don't want that because if you get it, you might be in aisle three of Publix and you start bursting out in tongues and you'll be weird in front of all these. And see, it's something that you control. Yeah. I do speak in tongues, but I control it. I don't walk into a certain place and all of a sudden I get all emotional and start speaking in this language and everyone looks at me weird. Yeah. So it's not that at all. And so, you know, just like you said, get the Bible, get the truth.
And then there's the tongues, and I talked about this on Sunday. There's the tongues that the apostles had when at Pentecost, the ability to speak in languages. And I've heard of missionaries that had that. Yeah. And so that, I mean, here's the deal. That's not even listed as a gift. The Holy Spirit can do whatever he wants to do to help us get done what he wants us to get done.
Yeah.
That's the thing I talk. Do not put the Holy Spirit in a box. Do not go, I'm not qualified for this, or I don't have the ability to do this. If God's called you into it, he's going to provide the resources for you to do it.
Yeah.
But yeah, to be fearful of any of the gifts is just a lack of knowledge of how important they are and really what they are so many times.
I got to put Melissa on the spot. Can we all do that?
Yeah,
so, let's do Josh.
Your perception. You've been at Grace a few years. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure, where do you land? Do you come out of a traditional background, charismatic background? I mean,
I come from more of a Pentecostal church where in my kind of youth small group environment, we prayed and I received my prayer language when I was an early teenager.
Cool. I didn't even know that about you.
Yeah. But never in my church did I ever experience the public speaking in tongues with someone interpreting. So that, when the first time I experienced that, it wasn't here. It was kind of church between there and here. And it was the gun-shy kind of moment, like, okay, that's something I know I do in private, and that really I feel connected to God, and it's so meaningful to me. But I did want to also ask you guys, when is the interpretation required? When does the Bible talk about that? But I think if you just realize exactly what Pastor Hall just said, the Holy Spirit can do anything.
Yeah.
And if you take these, like, norm guards off your mind, and say, Holy Spirit's going to guide you if this is of him or not of him, what you're walking through. So that was kind of my background.
The Bible is very, Paul is very clear on what speaking in tongues looks like corporately and privately. So you read 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14. He's very clear on what it looks like. And it seems like there are a lot of denominations and churches that overlook that. But he's very clear. Like, there's
it's
no room.
Chaos.
Because, and the reason that Paul is writing that to the Corinthian church, because they were speaking in tongues. They love Jesus. He praises them. And, man, you guys are doing a great job. You're
gifted.
Awesome. Hey, but there's a couple areas that you guys aren't administering well. And tongues was one of those areas. So he says, hey, here's what worship should look like publicly when you're speaking in tongues. So he's very clear. He says the person that speaks in tongues edifies themselves for God. It's not for everybody. So there is a corporate worship. He's talking about there's a corporate worship where he's speaking, I'm speaking, but we're not trying to outspeak each other. This is I'm speaking. And if you hear me, it's only because you're in proximity of me. It's not because I'm trying to be like, you need to hear me speaking in tongues, Hyundai, Toyota, Sonai. So it's not. It is, I am speaking my own personal language. But this is about me and God. That's one thing. But then there's the loud and there's the boisterous. And Paul says when two or three are together, he says, I mean, you can read it yourself. So don't. Take my word for it. Go read it. He said, when two or three are together or more together and they're speaking that loud, you should expect someone to interpret. He says, you should actually pray that someone will interpret. So even Paul is going, hey, there is a disorder when we're trying to outspeak each other loudly so that everyone could hear. Because on one side, he says, it brings the non-believer to go, wow, I want some of that. Mm-hmm. On the other side, it is like, confusion. Well, then where's the, there's confusion because there's no interpretation because we don't know what's been said. Mm-hmm. And so is it difficult to sometimes manage what that looked like? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But there's also, you are in complete control of that. Yeah. The gift is not in control of you. Mm-hmm. You are in control of the gift. Yeah. So you get to choose. Like I've heard people say, well, I was just loud because the Holy Spirit made me loud.
Yeah.
No. I was just doing it because that's what the Holy Spirit made me doing. No, the Holy Spirit is a gentleman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he's not making you do anything. Mm-hmm. So we have free will, which you talk about. We can quench. If we didn't have free will, we couldn't quench the Spirit because he made me do something. Mm-hmm. So it's like, no, I'm inviting you to be a part of my life. Yeah. And I want to do this. And I want to get it right. I want to edify God. I want people to be amazed by what you do. But I also don't want to be a distraction to what God is calling us to do. Yeah. And so I would tell anybody, hey, read 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14. And then when you read that, then you can walk away with a clear understanding of what speaking in tongues look like privately and corporately.
And I tell you what it does for me privately. In Romans, it says, when you know not how to pray, the Spirit prays for you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You ever have a situation, a person, a situation, a circumstance, you go, man, I don't know how to pray in English about this. I'm like, I'm overwhelmed. Mm-hmm. I don't even know where to begin for this person. Yep. And a lot of times in my walks in prayer, my prayer walks, I'll pray. Just pray in tongues for that situation. I don't know what I'm saying. That's another thing. When you pray, the Bible says your mind is unfruitful.
Yeah.
You're just praying in a language, believing that the Holy Spirit knows exactly what needs to be prayed. And that's just one dimension of prayer.
Yeah.
About that.
You know, this isn't in the notes, but as we're talking about it, I think probably the gift that tends to be the most, if we want to use the word abused, it would be prophecy. Mm-hmm. And there's a reason why the Bible says that we should test what people say, because people love to say, God told me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I just say this? Don't say that. I think the best thing to go is, I feel like God wants me to tell you this.
I sense this.
Yeah. Because when you say God told me, you're just putting a stamp on it.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like, well, I can't say anything about that. And here's the deal. I've thought God's told me something before, and I was very wrong.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't true. And so you'll have people, there's just something about some people will go, well, God told me this. And really, the gift of prophecy is not a fortune-telling thing. It is encouragement. It's something that they need to be able to step forward in what's going on. It's not in 3 months, this is going to happen. Not that God can't do that. Not that God doesn't send dreams and all those kind of things.
Yeah.
But the gift of prophecy is New Testament prophecy and Old Testament prophecy. There's a difference that's there. But at the same time, if someone claims to have that gift, we're going to test it. Yeah. We're going to see if it's right or it's wrong because it is. It's one of those things. But it's a great gift that helps people move forward, a great encouragement, all those things.
If you've had a bad experience, though, don't shy away
from
wanting more of the Holy Spirit in your life. I mean, listen, the Holy Spirit is not weird. People are weird.
Yeah.
People get weird.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
That's true.
So I think a question that I get in regards to Grace Family Church is, okay, if I want to have a conversation or pursue receiving a spirit language, or, you know, I want to guide my kids through that, what's the right environment for them to do that? What does that look like at this church?
Two things. One is we have freedom. It's a class that talks about a lot of your past, but we have an encounter weekend, because throughout the freedom class, they're talking about the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And they call it an encounter weekend, where people come on a Friday and a Saturday and they can be prayed for if they want it. No one's forced to. Mm-hmm. Shouldn't force people to do anything. Or if during a service and you feel, it can be talking about something else, but you go, you know, I just want someone to pray for me about the Holy Spirit. You go to the front and some of our prayer team will pray for you.
Yeah.
Or it can be in your small group. People that are aware or feeling, hey, would you mind? Because maybe someone who has that, and you go, I want more of the Holy Spirit. So it's a lot of those are three venues or probably or more. But
And I'll just say this, and I said this in the message, and it's something I always remember. We should desire all the gifts, the gifts, and be careful in just wanting a certain gift or this gift or the other gift or what. God may give that to you, but be careful in that, because I had several people come up to me and say, thank you for saying not everybody gets every gift, because I felt this way growing up. I felt like I was not a part, all of that. And so one of the things we should be desiring, we should be asked to be filled with the Holy Spirit on a regular basis, have people pray for you. And I mean, if you know people that, man, have giftings, of course, have them pray for you, all those things, but make sure that you're on I'm desiring the gifts so that I can use them from God, versus the envy of, man, that's really cool, they have that.
Or show off.
And everybody likes them because they have that gift or whatever it may be.
Yep.
And so there's there's the both sides of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You don't need to post about it. Whatever your gift is, right? Or you get touched with a gift. You don't need to post about it and let the whole world know.
Well, I have the gift of singing, but Daryl hasn't noticed it yet. So I'm still not on the worship team.
But not singing well, but day. I think you have the gift of singing.
There is a
absolutely.
We forget that the Bible says we are all one body, different parts.
Yes, different parts. That is true.
Different parts. And so, you know, your prayer should be, God, reveal to me my part.
Yeah, it's good.
What's my
part?
Every
part's important.
Every part is important. So, God, what's my part? There's, what do we mention? 15 gifts. So there are 13 to 15 different gifts.
Yeah.
God, which one is my part? Yeah. And how do you want to use me in this? And you never know, but whatever you get, it's going to be rewarding for your life and for the kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And in the body, the eye is not jealous of the hand.
Right.
Right. Right. Everyone has this unique part to them.
Yeah.
And I will say this, regarding the culture we're in today, where there's so much intimidation to stand for what you believe, one of the biggest manifestations of the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts is it said they spoke the word with boldness because they were filled with the Holy Spirit and they spoke with boldness. If there's one thing we should be praying for, God, fill me with your Holy Spirit so I can speak with more boldness in the workplace, at my school. Not brashness, not to my being brash, but bold enough to say, this is who I am and this is what I believe. And so we need more of that. I'll say that.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I'll just add this to it. And I think we've said this before. I think a lot of times people go, well, my gifting is not in front of everybody, so it's not that big of a deal or whatever it may be. I talk to people all the time, like, why did you come back to Grace Family Church? What was the most important thing? And they're like, it was the way I was greeted when I came in. Mm-hmm. Or it was the people that greeted my kids when they came in. My kids wanted to come back, so we came back. We really didn't like the message, but we came back because my kids did.
That was Daryl's
Or, you know, the small group that I have is, you know, and so I think so often we can get enamored with what's happening on stage, but guys, if we were just the stage, we wouldn't last. There'd be nothing to it. Ministry happens in so many different facets, and to break down what the Holy Spirit does to just what happens on stage is to lessen his power in such an incredible
That's
way
good.
So we're on stage 35 minutes. The stage is 45 minutes top where we're going back 48 minutes. We're on I'm just talking about myself. We're on stage for a very short time. So if my ministry was just what happens on stage, we're forgetting all the other hours in ministry that happen throughout the week. Mm-hmm. And everyone has a ministry that's for somebody else. Yeah. Mm-hmm. When people say, no, you know, mine is just for back here. No, everyone that has, it's the fruit. I shared this last week that the fruit is not designed for the tree. Mm-hmm. The tree never gets to eat the fruit. Mm-hmm. The purpose of the fruit is to be given away to somebody else.
That's others.
Good. Yeah. So the whole point of goodness and faithfulness and self-discipline is not for you.
Right.
It is to display the glory and the light of God so that someone else get that. The prophecy isn't for you. The miracles, the healing, it's not for you. It's for someone else. Yeah. And so God gives us these things so we can share with someone else. And for, you know, I would encourage the person that says, man, I don't know what my gift is. I bet you have it. And maybe you're just not being aware of it. Or maybe you're not even asking. God, show it. And maybe you're scared that God will show it to you. Yeah. And now it holds you accountable to actually knowing what it is. Yeah. But God doesn't want you to sit on your gifts. He doesn't want you to sit on your talents. He wants you to give those things away. Yeah. And I've learned that when you don't give your fruit away, that fruit turns bitter.
Mm. That's good.
And so you've got to give it to someone else and don't let it just sit dormant and stay bitter.
That's good.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
Any closing thoughts as we just dove more into the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, and the scary week that we all have ahead?
I would say this. We started a series on prayer. We did it purposely because we know we got the elections coming up. And as we've been talking, no matter who wins on November 6th, Jesus is still king.
Yeah.
And I think Christians need to really believe that and hold on to that. No matter who's in government, it tells us in Romans and in Acts and different places, Paul said, pray for those in authority. Mm-hmm. So whoever, we need to be always praying for our leadership. But we do believe everyone should go and vote for sure.
Absolutely.
And we say this, we said it last week, people should vote based on their biblical convictions and conscience.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You know, that's how we should vote. And
Yeah.
But, you know, that's some good stuff coming up.
Yeah. I'm excited for this prayer series. Awesome.
Yeah.
Listen, I'll say it again, the battle is won in prayer. It's one of our greatest mm-hmm. weapons and tools. You know, if it's not just the word of God, it's prayer. And so, mm-hmm. and they work hand in hand.
Yes.
We pray the word of God. Mm-hmm. And so, man, you want to be a part of this because we're going to be praying in mm-hmm. service. We're going to be praying for our leaders, for our yep. country, for our families. And yes. so mm-hmm. come be a part of this. This is going to be an amazing series.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. And we just need to do a little like recount or correction. Last week, we did mention a book called The Secret, which is not a book that we endorse. We were supposed to
the
say.
The Secret was Oprah Winfrey's. This one is called Surrender the Secret.
Yes.
Surrender
Perfect.
The Secret.
Yeah.
Very different
so
book.
That was my mess up.
Yes,
yeah.
That's okay. Surrender the Secret by Pat Lee, and we'll link it if
it's
you want to listen to it.
It's a book on healing of those who've been through an abortion.
Yes.
Yes.
And God does heal and forgive and redeem. Mm-hmm. We know that about our God.
So. Yes.
Amen. Yeah. Well, thank you guys. And you know what? It's time to eat. So thank you, Fourth Garage Wesley Chapel. Let's eat. Thank you, Ford's Garage, Wesley Chapel, for life.
Oh, my goodness. Come on.
Oh,
now.
Here we go. My gosh.
Ribs. That looks like some nice
These
ribs.
These guys, they had asked wings. Me if they should Thank bring you, in Megan. Some salad, Megan
Ooh,
asked.
Yeah, look at
and
this.
I said, Craig will not
Craig
no,
doesn't
care
believe,
for that
believe
at
salad
all.
Is a human
being.
My wife
doesn't
want to hear that, but yeah.
And
man.
Thank you so good. Much.
Come on now. Mac and cheese.
All right.
Are these chicken tenders?
Thank you, Megan.
Barbecue.
Thank you, Ford's Garage, Wesley Chapel. Thank you guys so much.
Go check them out. They're good. I'm serious.
Daryl's got the whole
Let's
bib
dig
and everything
Come on,
going
man.
On, man. You're ready to get in.
I'm
good
ready.
Idea.
I'm ready to go.
There we go.
And thank you guys for being with us for another episode of The Pastor's Hangover. We will see you all.
Wait. This bus food.
Oh, yes.
Okay. God's neat. Let's eat. Amen.
Amen.
There we go.
Amen. All right.
Amen.
One bite. Everybody knows the rules.
Ooh, man. Come on now.
All right. I'm a lady, so we're going to cut the camera before I stick my face in these wings.
Oh, yeah. That's a really good one.
Okay. I see what you're doing here. Mm-hmm. I see what you're doing.
Good. Thank you guys for being with us.
Hey, Daryl got more than me.
Next week. Bye.
That's life.